I know some of you don't get to see me very often. And you might wonder who I am. But I know who you are, and I think you know who I am. And it's a delight to be with you again this morning as we participate in a worship service. That song you heard is by a famous band called The Who, I think. Is there anyone here who hasn't heard that song? Wow, yeah. Oh, one person? Really? Must not be living in the United States or Europe or Australia. Oh, he's 10 years old. Well, maybe that's a good thing. Yeah, that song, of course, you know, was written by that great British Sufi theologian, Peter Townsend. I say Sufi theologian with my tongue buried deeply in my cheek. But you know, his song, in an interview, he explained that he based that song on a Sufi chant. So hence my little comment about it being Sufi theology. I think Peter Townsend's a much better guitar player than he is a theologian. Although he asks a very important question, who are you? Because we want to know who God is, and you're not going to know who you are until you know who God is. The chorus, who, 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 that's the part that's based on the Sufi chant. But that question is important to all of us. And I think you've already seen that this conference theme has been one of renewal. And I want to at least pass on my thanks. I probably have heard from 20 people now. I was trying to keep a tally in my mind and of how much they've enjoyed this conference. Not only the good information, but the pace. Because, you know, in past, our conferences were often likened unto drinking from a fire hose. You know, we're just running one place to another and never had free time. And it was an evening meeting every time. And this time we actually had some space of free time. So I'm glad that a lot of you saw that we made time for some fellowship, and so you're not constantly sipping from the fire hose. And this conference being about renewal, that notion of renewal is not just about extending our vitality. You recall Jeff McSwain made a comment that the GCI is dying. And I had four people ask me, what does he mean? And I said, well, one of them said, is that true? And I said, the answer is yes and no. In the U.S., if I'll digress for a moment, we used to have 400 congregations. We're now 300 congregations. Internationally, we used to have 400 congregations. They're now 500 congregations. And so our prayer is that we'll start growing here in the United States like they're growing internationally. And the picture is this. In the United States, we have those 300 churches. And so in roughly speaking, 50 of those churches are thriving and adding new members. They're growing. And another 100 are what I call treading water. They get new people, and that's a blessing, and we love that. But just as many die. We have a lot of elderly people. The warranty wears out sometime, well, for some people it's in the 60s, and some people it's in the 80s, and, well, for some people it's in the 100s. So praise God, whatever your warranty is, he has the best plan for you. And so we want the same thing that's currently taking place internationally to happen here. And that will happen as we participate in ministry with Jesus. Each one of us can make a difference. That's God's plan. And my message for today, whether we experience renewal or realize renewal, is this. When we focus upon our true identity, you can't help but be renewed. Knowing who God is and who he made us to be gives us a vitality to co-minister with Jesus. Now, the problem of identity is one that plagues our entire culture and Western society. On the next slide, I ask the question, where is your identity? Notice I didn't ask who you are, as I did in the beginning. I'm asking, where is your identity? Social sciences do us a bit of a disservice. They refer to our identity as with certain elements of self-perception. In fact, sociologists and psychologists don't even agree on a definition of identity, because psychologists are more looking towards personality development, and sociologists are looking more towards culture. And when we think of our identity, usually people first think of the language they speak, their nationality, their people group, or they might think of their race, or they might think of whether they're free or whether they're a slave. In this time when slavery is illegal, there are still lots of slaves. People are slaves to their job. People are slaves to their substance. People are slaves to all kinds of things. They don't experience the freedom that we have in Christ. And some people perceive themselves and their identity in all these different ways that fragment us. In fact, a sociologist's definition of identity is those things that cause you to cohere and those things that cause you to fragment. And do you know that the things that cause you to fragment are increasing? You used to be, and I used to be, identified by, well, how I dress and whether I'm male or female and whether I'm white or black or red or yellow or whether you're ugly or pretty. Men are really big on that one. Whether you're VIP or part of the riffraff. And now it increases. People are now adding to their identity whether they're a foodie. You know what a foodie is, you know, people. Or people are adding to their identity of whether they're a coffee snob. You think I'm making this up, but I'm not. This is true, and I know that's why some of you are laughing. You know, unless you're getting single source organic fresh coffee, you're drinking a pagan substitute. And there are beer snobs and wine snobs, but I don't want to digress too far. If you were to ask the question of any typical high school student, perhaps a college student, who are you? What's your identity? They might say something like this: I am what my genes make me. I am what I experience. Or, as is frequently occurring in our day and age, I am what I choose. And some of the social media, things like Facebook, are advancing the fragmentation of our identity. And there's a distinction being made between what we know as male and female, and that's not good enough anymore. Now you have a sex identity, male or female, a biological identity, but we also have a gender identity, what you feel you are. So we're bifurcating our identity and fragmenting it even more in Western society. And what we find with culture and society is it's moving in two different directions on this issue of the bifurcation of sex identity and gender identity. And it's all been a result of a political agenda and propaganda. When I talk about those two different directions, let me focus on the first one. The first one is what you have seen in the last several years, the growing advocating of same-sex marriage, right? Anyone missed that in society? I mean, you can't watch a TV show. A survey was done this last year asking college age and high school age children, what's the percentage of homosexuals vis-a-vis heterosexuals in America? You know what they said? 50%. It's less than 3%. But do you know why they say 50%? Because that's all they see. That's what they see in the movies. That's what they see in television. That's what they read in the books. That's what they're being taught in the classrooms. It's not true. It's not reality. And so, following an agenda that was developed back in the 1980s, it was called the Gay Manifesto. There was a book written about the ball, after the ball. And the book outlines how to get the public consciousness to accept gayness as normal. And the idea was to present it as you're a victim. And if the rest of the people don't see you as a victim, they're not going to have any compassion for you, and they're not going to ever accept you. So they were painted to be victims. And then along with that, the next part of their strategy was to say that you have no choice. You know, Lady Gaga sings, "I was born this way." Right? She's not the only one. I'm not into rap music, but I force myself to listen about 20 minutes a day just so I can hear the cultural messages. That's a good thing for pastors to do. Be aware of the cultural messages. And there's a guy named Macklemore, and he says the same thing in his rap. "I was born this way, and I can't change even if I wanted to." So we have one message going out there, which is not scientifically verified or validated, that you have no choice. You're born this way. And I mentioned that society's moving in another direction. On the next slide, I illustrate that by two covers of Time magazine last year. And there's a new narrative coming out. It's a narrative that's being promoted in the arena of public thinking, the court of public thinking, as evidenced by these two covers. And you've probably heard this acronym, LBGT, right? Or that, you know what those letters stand for. But that's not sufficient anymore. It has lengthened. In fact, in the time I was preparing this sermon, I discovered that I was out of date. And I found, well, it's LBGTQ. Then, and I said, no, that's out of date too. It's LBGTQQ. No, well, and one Q stands for queer, and the other Q stands for questioning. And then the latest is LBGTQQIAP2SAA. I can't even remember what all the letters stand for. I mean, I used to be proud that I could recite pi 5 decimals, you know, 3.14. This has gone beyond me. I can't keep up with all the letters. But the new narrative, the new mantra in society is not that I was born this way, but I want to change, I have the right to change, and I can and will change. So the public is entering another phase of being propagandized. And on Facebook, for those of you who might do Facebook, I steadfastly avoid it. There's a list of 52 gender choices. I was shocked. I didn't know this was going on. I knew about LBGT, LBGTQ, and all this, but I mean, a person can declare themselves agender, which is trying to be neither a man or a woman. I think that's a state of confusion, but you have some people who want to self-identify as, I am not a man, I am not a woman. And I can't help my sense of humor when I say, well, what are you, a nematode? But this is a legitimate new gender classification. And if that's not enough, trying to be neither man or woman, there's androgyne, which is trying to be both man and woman at the same time. But then there are some who, well, I can't be both at the same time, and they call themselves bigender. This means, well, today I'm going to be a woman, and then the next day when they wake up, I think today I'm going to be man. Or I'm going to be woman till lunch, and then after lunch, I'll be man. And then there's those who just don't want any of that, and they just call it gender questioning, and they don't know. And it's all feeling-based, and I haven't memorized all 52. I thought just remembering that many, was sufficient. But let's look at identity choices and look at it from the beginning. At the risk of sounding like Herbert Armstrong, let's look at the beginning. But then when Gary Detter said, if we're going to look at renewal, we have to look at Newell. So at the risk of sounding both like HWA and Gary Detter, let's go to the beginning. On the next slide, I have a nice little kind of picture of creation. And I'm a real fan of the late Episcopalian scholar named Robert Capon. And he, in a book he wrote, expresses that creation is like watching a movie with God the Father as the producer, the Holy Spirit as the director, and Jesus Christ is the main starring actor in this movie. I really like that that perspective. And he writes this book on creation to give us or to coach us on how to properly read the book of Genesis. And he explains in the first chapter of his book and about the first chapter of Genesis that God delights in goodness. And he mentions a verse in the Proverbs and one in the Psalms where the actual translation is that God cavorts with wisdom. And if you don't use the word cavort very often, it means to jump up and down in excitement. And it's a wonderful picture that the Bible gives us of God. He jumps up and down with excitement as he creates. He cavorts with wisdom. And when you read in our English Bibles that chapter 1 of Genesis, you'll notice it says 7 times, it is good. What God created, it is good. It's because he delights in goodness. If you read it in the Greek Bible, it says it 8 times. I haven't quite figured out why that is, but I'm excited to know it. And because God delights in goodness, he delights in creation. The best way I can maybe illustrate that is using cooking as a illustration. You know, you all have your favorite dish, right? Maybe it's waffles. And you'll go through the extra time it takes to get the ingredients out and mix it up and make the batter. You know, you can buy the pre-made batter, but it's not the same. And those who love waffles know it's not the same, right? It's like you can buy pre-ground coffee, but it's not the same as single source organic. One of the things that I like is a properly barbecued steak. And when I say properly, there's more information in the properly than in the steak. First, you know, you have to get the right cut. And for my taste, it should be a ribeye. And if you can, the center cut ribeye. And then you just don't throw it on the grill. Oh, no. Oh, just what barbaric behavior. It must be properly rubbed. Right? And you must make a black garlic butter sauce to finish it. Now you're singing my song. But you have your favorite dish. You know what you like to order and perhaps what restaurant makes it the best. Or if you're a real foodie, you know you make it better than the restaurant. Well, that same way in which you delight in your favorite dish, God delights in goodness and in creation. And I think renewal happens the way we experience it in several ways, and I'm not going to give an exhaustive list, but I'll share a few ways. When you've been praying about something a while and earnestly, and then that prayer comes to happen just like you've been praying, how many here have had that happen? How'd it feel? Didn't it? You think, whoa, I'm having a good day. I've had prayers answered that made my year. Not just one day wasn't sufficient. It made my year. Some of you are answered prayers. It sometimes happens when there's a reconciliation. people who've been estranged or people who've been almost at each other's throats and enemies have a reconciliation. I've been party to that happening. I've even helped facilitate it at times. I have some deep friendships from those things that have happened over the years where I've been facilitating that kind of thing. And we still talk. We still text each other. We're close friends, closer than a brother. And you experience renewal. Another way, and I'll stop with this example, because I tend to preach a stream of consciousness, you know. And I go off, the stream just takes me. But you experience it when you understand something theologically that you didn't understand before. When you read a verse that you may have read 50 times, and then suddenly, my experience was, where have I been? I've read this verse. I've given sermons on with this verse. I didn't even know what I was talking about. And that is a renewing experience. I will never forget the day I'm reading Galatians 2, and I'm reading about Paul describing how he withstood Peter to the face, and he said, you know, Peter, why is it you, living like a Jew, are behaving and acting like a Gentile? Why aren't you staying faithful to Judaism? And suddenly, I mean, it wasn't just one switch that was flipped on. I mean, the whole bank turned on. It was like that scene in the movie with the Blues Brothers. The light was shining on me. I suddenly, in one moment, understood the new covenant. Fabulous. That's a renewal. And so we experience those things as we draw closer to God. And that's what this conference has been about. And the Holy Spirit works in us to bring us that joy, to develop and cultivate that fruit of the Holy Spirit within us. You know, we don't produce the fruit. We used to teach that we did. I hope we all realize. I mean, it's a very simple analogy. Tammy and I have two fruit trees in our backyard. We have a plum tree and a peach tree. I am under no belief at all that I produced the peaches or the plums on that tree. In fact, I've been praying mightily about that plum tree. I want a bigger yield. We have a little dwarf peach tree, and we'll get as many as 60 peaches off that little thing. You know, and so we prune it, and we keep the weeds and cut the suckers off these stray things that grow up out of it. And, you know, we participate in what the tree is doing, what God ordained that tree to do. And the same thing is true with the Holy Spirit. He produces fruit in us. And the more closely we draw to God, the more we participate in what Jesus is doing, the more you'll see some fruit developed. Now, when I said we're going back to the beginning, let me, on the next slide, take us to our genetic structure. And you've probably heard the old bad joke, how do you tell the difference between a male chromosome and a female chromosome? You take down their genes. Terrible joke. I know. It's a groaner. It's a groaner. I remember it from biology class, and it's one of those earworms. I can't get it out of my head now. But chromosomes are an amazing thing. Everybody has them. Every living thing, every species of plant and animal has chromosomes and a specific number, or you're not that species. Humans have 23 pairs. Apes, gorillas, they have 24 pairs. Fruit flies have 4 pairs. A rice plant has 12 pairs. Dog has 39 pairs. I can't remember anymore now. I tried to memorize a longer list. I should write them down. And this genetic code is a fascinating thing. You can go online. You've probably seen the TV commercials for 23andMe.com. They send you a kit. Well, you have to pay $200 to get the kit. But then you swab and send it back, and then they'll send you an incredible printout of information based on your DNA. And as people have found, they're not who they think they are. There's a a commercial, one of the commercials they do is this guy, he thought that he was German. And his parents told him he was German. And so he'd eat German food, and he even had a pair of Lederhosen. How many have seen this commercial? Oh, quite a few of you, yeah. And he got the information back and found, I'm not German at all, I'm Scottish. And he traded in his Lederhosen for a kilt. Yeah, it's... Let that sink into the British Israelism idea, too, there for a moment. You've probably heard of the genetic expert scientist named Francis Collins. He was an atheist, and he became a Christian. And in his interviews, he's explained he became a Christian by reading C.S. Lewis's books. It spoke to him. It somehow got through the barrier and the religion of atheism into his heart. And he was selected to be in charge of the DNA project, you know, breaking the genetic code, and they succeeded. And he wrote a book about it. I'm trying to remember the name of the book, Language of God. And in The Language of God, he explains that the DNA is God's instruction book. And one of the conclusions that he makes in his book, and that's the only reason I'm off on a tangent telling you this, is that he says people mistakenly think that God is not involved. God is like the invisible unicorn. He doesn't exist. And people ask, why is God silent? And Francis Collins says, he's screaming at us through the DNA. The DNA can't write itself. The DNA is complex information. Einstein said that there is no way that matter can come up with information. There has to be an intelligent source. DNA didn't come about on its own. There's a code there. There's a design there. There's a language there. And that's why he titled the book Language of God. Boy, I'm really off on a tangent now. There was a court case involving a Utah company named Myriad Genetics, and they were building on Francis Collins' work. And they came up with a test because they broke the code, they keep finding more and more things, and they discovered the gene that causes breast cancer. And they came up with a test to discover if a woman will get breast cancer. Very expensive, thousands of dollars for the test. Well, you and I can't afford that test, and insurance won't pay for it either. It's just way too expensive. But some rich people can pay for it. You've heard the name Angelina Jolie? Yeah, she paid for it. Found out she's got the bad gene. That's why her mother died at 59, and so she had the surgery. Well, a court case ensued, and because it's so expensive and it's not helping the population, if only rich people can afford it, and it went all the way to the Supreme Court. Did you hear about this? We don't get the news. We get propaganda. But it went all the way to the Supreme Court, and Clarence Thomas was the Supreme Court justice who wrote the majority opinion. And he said, and I don't remember word for word, but I can summarize what his opinion was for the majority of the court, that the genetics company, they're not the ones who created anything. And so they have no right to patent it. That all they did was helpfully, usefully separate the gene sequence to find out more. But the genetic material was already there. There was no act of invention. And so they lost the case and lost their patent. And I was gratified that the Supreme Court finally got something right. I'll get off my tangent. Next slide. A verse in our memory, I think everyone has this memorized, right? Genesis 1:26. Then God said, let us make man in our image and our likeness. And you look at this up in commentaries, and you'll find that there's essentially three or four ways that it's explained. Some say that it's the royal we. The angels are there watching God create the universe, and it's kind of like a cooking TV show. Everyone's watching the cook, and the cook says, now we put this in, and now we put, well, everyone else isn't putting it in. He's speaking for the whole group, right? The royal we. And then some say, no, it's just making the distinction between humans and God. And another says, well, you know, that's a plural noun, and it takes a plural pronoun, and there's a hint of the Trinity there. And, you know, those aren't conflicting or competing. Since they don't conflict, I don't think there's any need to discount any of those. I think they're all equally valid. But there's more than just those items. And commentators, some of them are willing to point out that the explanation of what this means, making man in our image and our likeness, has over the years followed the zeitgeist of the time that you're working. Whatever culture and society feels about it, they'll somehow mix that into the explanation of what this means. But there's, I think all theologians agree, there's three basic things here that are being communicated to us, that man and woman are being set apart from everything else God made. That's one of the primary meanings of we are made in the likeness and image of God. A second one is that we're preeminent in his creation. God gives us dominion. We were co-regents. Adam and Eve were to be co-regents with God. And the third one is that they were created from the dust of the earth. And there's a whole picture there of they're mortal. They didn't get created with the immortal soul. This is something that came from the Greeks and made its way into the church. And remember, Paul says, mortality must put on immortality. And I think we all know you don't put more immortality on by yourself, do you? Don't see anybody doing that, do you? And this isn't the only time it's mentioned. Just a couple chapters forward on the next slide, Genesis 5:1, you see it repeated. This is the book of generations of Adam. When God created man, he created him in the likeness of God. Male and female, he created them, and he blessed them and named them man when they were created. So don't get confused now, because in modern society, when it says man on the door, you expect women not to go in. But, you know, originally, what, you know, that was a title for all humanity, not just the men. And I'm not going to read any more in Genesis 5 because we've got a bunch of genealogical lists. But just so you know, there's an order and a pattern to it. There's genealogy, then there's some narrative about it. Then there's genealogy and some more narrative about it. So there's a reason for it there. To illustrate why, it's sort of like in my family, my grandparents would say, well, you got my dad was this name, and my mom was this name, and his dad, they came from here, and it's the story. My grandparents would tell me their romantic story of coming from Svidnik and Hrabovchek to New York and then to Chicago, and you know, there's narrative there, there's story, and that's the pattern. So there's a purpose for that genealogy. And you'll notice here in Genesis 5, though, it doesn't repeat in it just says likeness. It doesn't repeat in image. And what we ought to glean from that is it's called a hendiadys. It's two words that are just reinforcing each other. You know, it's like warm and cozy. You can separate them, but it wasn't meant to be separated. So we're created in God's image and in his likeness. And there's nothing really we're supposed to dissect out of those two words that are being used that are different. It doesn't repeat in the other places. So it's probably just the hendiadys. But in the Old Testament, being in God's image is an explicit theme that we see repeated in Genesis 1, in Genesis 5, as well as in Genesis 9. And it gives us this picture that I mentioned, these three items. We're set apart from everything else God made. We're elevated. We're to be co-regents with God. And we're mortal. And the role of Adam and Eve were, well, they were to be directing God's love through creation. They were created innocent, but they weren't created perfect. And you know the story that went on from there. Karl Barth has a great quote. He says, a genuine counterpart in God himself leading to unanimous decision is the secret prototype, which is the basis of an obvious copy, a secret image, and an obvious reflection in the coexistence of God and man, and also of the existence of man himself. Okay. The whole reason I'm giving this sermon is to try to make sense out of that for you. On the next slide, the point you need to gather from some of that is God made male and female, and he made us ontological equals. And this is something that was taught by not only Karl Barth, but Dietrich Bonhoeffer and the Torrance brothers and all of us too. And from the moment of existence, it's an interesting thing. We are dependent upon relationship. We are from others, we are by others, and we are toward others. Isn't that true? I mean, I don't think any of you arrived in an egg from Mars. We are all based on our DNA and image of our predecessors. The half of the chromosomes you get from your dad and the half you get from your mom, and their relationship. And what we glean from all of this, as Bart and Bonhoeffer and the Torrances and others have taught, the understanding of the image of God comes from Trinitarian personhood. The Trinity is relational. God is a relational being, and he created us in his image and likeness. He created us as relational beings. That's the big point that we're to get out of being created in God's image and in his likeness. And you shouldn't buy into the bad theology of Simon and Garfunkel, who sang, "I am a rock, I am an island. A rock feels no pain, and an island never cries." Huh. We are not a rock. We are not an island. We are relational. That's the way we were created. You try to deny that, and all you do is make yourself crazy. One of the reasons God had Adam name the animals, well, actually, it was for a very specific purpose, because Adam sees that the animals have male and female, that they're all pairs. And Adam sees, hey, they all got someone on their side. I got no one on my side. And then God created Eve. He saw that animals were not his ontological equal, and he needed one. And God made him one. And so this notion that when we sometimes introduce our wife as our better half, that's theologically insightful. Adam, you recall, I thought some people would like that. You'll recall Adam, when Eve was created from his rib, he said, "This is bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh." And there's a lot more going on there than just a poetic reference. You know, when Adam fell into the deep sleep, and this was not the first surgery performed, surgery wasn't known until way, 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 way long after that. That's reading something into the text that shouldn't be there. You know, we did put him in a dream state. And in the dream state, he received this understanding, she is his ontological equal. So marriage is when ontological halves are joined together and become allies for a purpose. Male and female, he created them. And it's a mistake to interpret that as being the most important aspect of your personhood, that the most important aspect of my personhood is not that I'm male. The most important aspect of Tammy's personhood is not that she's female. First, because we're both created in his image. That's the most important feature of our personhood. That's the most important feature of our identity, that we're created in the image of God, male and female. Both men and women, biblically speaking, are bearers of God's image. And the emphasis is on the unity that's supposed to occur between the man and the woman, the ontological halves coming together. This idea that maleness and femaleness shapes our identity or is fundamental to the purpose of life, it's fairly pervasive in our society, and it traces all the way back to Aristotle. And Aristotle didn't have a high view of women. It comes from Greek philosophy. It's not the biblical perspective. The biblical perspective is we're ontologically equal halves joined together. Now, when we talk about our identity, next slide, I have a little cartoon. It says on your resume that you were created in God's image. Very impressive. And indeed it is. And let me try to explain or tease that out a bit more for our understanding. How much would you pay for a used toothbrush? I ain't going to pay much for it. In fact, I don't even want you to give it to me. $5? $2, $50, what would you pay for a used toothbrush? How about, what would you pay for a fake set of pearls? Fake pearls. You can buy them, you know, in the dime stores for like $5. How much would you pay for a fake set of pearls? Or how much would you pay for just a piece of sheet music that you could play on the piano. You go to the music stores, you know, and they'll sell for as high as $100 for, depending on the piece of music. Well, do you know that there was a sheet of music that sold for $1.5 million? Do you know that there was a toothbrush used that sold for $21,000? Yeah, do you know that there was a fake set of pearls, fake pearls, that sold for $250,000? Well, I think you might be ahead of me. You'll know why. That toothbrush belonged to Napoleon. That set of pearls belonged to Jackie Onassis Kennedy. And that piece of sheet music that sold for $1.5 million, that belonged to Beethoven. So you see that the worth and the value, the identity of something or someone is based on relationship, right? My toothbrush isn't going to sell for $21,000. And any sheet music I put together won't even sell for a penny. So the toothbrush was used, the pearls were fake, and the sheet music was just a piece of paper. But they weren't valuable because of what they were valuable because they had intrinsic worth for who they belonged to, right? You see that. And the Bible tells us the same thing about humanity, about men and women. We have value because of who owns us. That's what gives us our worth. That's what makes us valuable. God made us in his image. Apart from God, we don't exist. Apart from God, we're nothing. We're no one. Our very existence is rooted in God's creative will and our personal identity, which is founded on God's love for us. But what's happened is it's Adam and Eve all over again in society. On the next slide. This same theme is going on today. How many times have you heard it said, well, he's searching for himself? Or, she hasn't found herself yet. Well, in this fallen world, despite the public sentiment on rugged individuality, this fallen world is trying to cajole us and force us and squeeze everyone into a mold of who we are not. It happens in a number of ways. The liberalism of this world would want us to be defined by our feelings, as I already illustrated too. Today I feel like a woman. And after lunch I might feel like a man. Or the world tries to define us by how we earn money, or a certain status, or success, or let's narrow it down to materialism, or fame. You see the commercials on TV. You're identified by the car you drive. You're identified by the watch you wear. You're identified by the cologne or perfume you wear. This is the modern message. Your identity is in material things. In the commercials and advertisements are very clever, but they press that harder and harder as time moves forward. God wants us to know that we are bigger and more than the car we drive. We're bigger and more than the perfume or aftershave lotion or potion or toothpaste. We're bigger than those material things. He created us more than those things. We're more than the job we do to make money. We're more than the skin color, the tone of our color that we have. We're more than the genitalia we have. God created us bigger and made us more than those things. And our identity isn't wrapped up in those things. If it is, we're not listening to God's call. It's too much static on the line. Paul gives us that biblical rationale, you recall in Galatians, when he said that our identity is not based on nationality, it's not based on monetary status, it's not based on gender. It's based on having our identity in Christ. And one thing, while I'm on this, I should go to the next slide and mention that Adam and Eve being sent out of the Garden of Eden wasn't punishment. It's viewed that way. It was protection. And Adam and Eve's decision to disobey God didn't surprise God. Why? Because God knew from the beginning that they were going to blow it. That's why it's not plan B. That's why the Lamb was slain from the foundation of the earth. Now, I'm supposed to finish right now, and I have three more slides, so we'll blow through them fast. And next time I give this, I won't be able to digress. So you're getting the full-blown version. Others are going to miss out on all my humor. Colossians 1, verse 11. May you be strengthened with all power according to the glorious might for all endurance and patience with joy, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. Now, there's a phrase in there that I hope you don't miss and read over like I did other verses 50 times and never catch it. But notice, you remember Herbert Armstrong used to teach, yeah, God saves you, but then you must qualify for salvation. Anyone remember that? Yeah. What does Paul tell the Colossians? Who qualifies us? The Father. You can't qualify yourself. You can't do anything in eternity. Neither can I. God must be the one to qualify us. And it's a time to take 30 seconds of silence. I'll model confession and acknowledgement. It's a time right now for all of us to take 30 seconds and confess and acknowledge to God we've had things wrong and thank him that he's drawing us closer and closer to him. 30 seconds now. Thank you, Father, for your faithfulness, for drawing us to you, your forgiveness, for the times you carry us, which, frankly, is all the time. We tend to think of it as times when we fall down, but you're the one who's always carrying us. So thank you, Father, for that. Continuing in Colossians chapter 1, verse 13, next slide. He has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transformed us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, forgiveness of sins. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of creation. We have verses that tell us that he is the image of the invisible God. We have verses that tell us he's the fullness of the Godhead. We have verses that tell us that Christ is the image of God. Jesus says, whoever sees me sees the Father. We have verses that say he is the radiance of God's glory. He's the exact imprint of his nature. Jesus is the real image of God. And we have verses that tell us that he was slain from the foundation of the earth. So think about it. In the image we are created, who was the prototype? The one who is created and who was slain from the foundations of the earth. Well, it's Jesus. True humanity, the fullness of humanity, is Jesus. And he's transforming us. And if Jesus were to take a selfie, you know what selfies are now. This guy, this artist had a great version of this. So here's Jesus with the smartphone taking a selfie. Next slide, you see he's holding it up and he's got the selfie going. And then he looks at it. And there we are. Jeffrey Bromley, who helped T.F. Torrance translate Barth's work into English, said, in himself, Christ sums up all that humanity is to be. He is the perfect representation of God to man. God foreknew it all. We were included from the beginning. Next slide, Romans 8. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. Self-justification doesn't work. It doesn't work in real life, and it doesn't work in eternity. All the self-justifying in the world will not get you into the kingdom of God. In fact, it spoils the party for everyone. And God's not going to let those self-justifiers spoil the party. As Dr. Detto referred to in the next slide, 2 Corinthians 3:18, We all, with unveiled face, behold the glory of God and are transformed into the same image, one degree of glory to another. So as we're progressing from justification through our sanctification to eventually glorification, this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. And God's Spirit leads us to turn away from all alien forms of identity and see ourselves in Him. So on the next slide, repeat this with me. I am blessed, chosen, adopted, accepted, redeemed, and forgiven. That's a good identity. That's one that helps you operate and get through the hard times. Now, I want to conclude with giving you a little video clip and then make a comment.
Thank you.
Richard Gere for the ladies.
Thank you. You can go. I'm sure you have better things to do than dress me.
You have given me back my life itself.
Sean Connery.
The least I can do is give you back your shirt.
My lord.
Tell me what you want, and it's yours.
I did what any man would have done.
No, no. You risked your life for another. There is no greater love. You have deceived me. Now, I know the truth. The truth is, you care nothing for yourself. Well, look at you. No wealth, no home, no goal. Just the passionate spirit that drives you on. God uses people like you, Lachie. Because your heart is open. You hold nothing back. Give all of yourself.
If you knew me better, you wouldn't say such things.
Hey, I take the good with the bad, together. I can't love people in slices. Now, no more protests. Let me thank you in my own way.
Did you catch that phrase? I don't love people in slices. Interesting research that a psychologist named Ellen Lilly did, and she wrote about it in her book. She interviewed many parents, and parents would admit to her when they think about their children, they had a favorite, one that they did love a little bit more than the others. And she was amazed at how many parents that was true. And some would give that disclosure after several interviews. But God doesn't go by that kind of arithmetic. God doesn't love in fractions. The population of the earth today is 7.3 billion. You aren't loved only 1/7 billion. God doesn't have to fragment his love. He doesn't love in slices. He loves us completely, totally. I conclude with a quote by T.F. Torrance in his book, The Mediation of Christ. God loves you so utterly and completely that he has given himself for you in Jesus Christ, his beloved Son, and thereby pledged his very being as God for your salvation. In Jesus Christ, God has actualized his unconditional love for you in human nature in such a once and for all way that he cannot go back upon it without undoing the incarnation and the cross and thereby denying himself. Jesus Christ died for you precisely because you are sinful and utterly unworthy of him, and has thereby already made you his own before and apart from your ever believing in him. He has bound you so to himself by his love in a way that he will never let you go. For even if you refuse him and damn yourself in hell, his love will never cease. Therefore, repent and believe in Jesus as your Lord and Savior. That ought to be renewing. Join me in prayer. Father, our loving Heavenly Father, as we conclude, we have a whole list of items, a never-ending list of items to say thank you for. But we say at this time in brevity, we pray our hearts and minds are prepared now for the communion. We know that Jesus is the bread and the wine. He is our life. He renews us. And as we grow in our identity in him, we experience daily renewal. We pray that your Spirit will continue to cultivate more and more fruit in us. We pray, Father, that as we participate in ministry with you, you will perform more miracles among us. Not just the 50 churches that are thriving, but all 300. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.